you're sharing the pleasures of home and family on this very special day. We'd like to share some time with you. For the next half hour, we're going to show you some of the people who have meant a lot to us over the past year. We call them Carolina people. Stay with us now for a very special edition of the Carolinas at 5:30, Home for Christmas. Last few weeks have been a very busy time, people getting in their last-minute Christmas shopping and so forth, getting ready for today. Others have been making travel plans, and they've had a tough time even getting an airplane ticket. Well, speaking of flying, over the past year, we met a lady who took us back in the days of flying, before there were modern jets and so forth. She told us about a person who, she says, took to the skies before the Wright brothers.
December 17th, 1903, Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. The history-making flight by Orville and Wilbur Wright. But were the Wright brothers really the first to fly? For 50 years, Stella Randolph, who now lives in Wilmington, has argued that it was in fact a German-born American, Gustav Whitehead, who was the first in the sky. The 88-year-old Wilmington author claims Whitehead took to the skies more than 2 years before the Wright brothers. And now, for the first time, Ms. Randolph says a federal agency has acknowledged Whitehead's flight.
I wonder why it took so long for this to be acknowledged.
He had no money and he didn't have very much backing. He had two or three backers who had a few hundred dollars they could help him with, but he didn't really have much support with his work. And he didn't become known as I think he would have if he'd been American and been born here.
Miss Randolph has written two books about the flights of Gustav Whitehead. In her first, in 1937, Randolph cited statements by witnesses and newspaper accounts to support her claim. She says Whitehead first achieved flight at Bridgeport, Connecticut, August 14, 1901.
I never have had a picture of him in flight. However, there were pictures taken of him in flight. And One of those was displayed this past year in a book that came out, strangely enough, from one of the from the staff of Smithsonian Institution.
But the Smithsonian Institution in Washington has been avoiding counterclaims to the Wright brothers' flight. It's part of an agreement giving the institution control of the historic plane. So now it appears all of her years of investigation just may have paid off. But if you think just getting in the air has been a chore for people like the pioneers, or for you this Christmas, one trip this year has been a labor of love for two ladies we met in Leland.
We found the people very destitute of food, very sick, so much sickness, it was appalling.
Rose Ellen Lewis of Winnebo has recently returned from a month-long missionary trip to Thailand. It was the first time she had been out of the United States. When her pastor at the Mission of Christ in Leland asked her to go, Rose says it took her a few weeks to think it over. But 61-year-old Rose decided to go overseas, a decision eventually supported by her husband. When she arrived at the small, remote Thai village last December, she found the 70 or so residents living in deplorable conditions. There had been no rice crop in 4 years.
The villagers were starving, and it was nothing to see people lying in the floor just vomiting from lack of food or pass out from exertion because there were the blood sugar in their bodies were so low, just simply faint. It was very bad.
Mrs. Lewis says she traveled to a nearby town to get food and other articles for the villagers. Rose immediately began teaching the people about Christ and organized a church. But Rose was not alone on her mission to Thailand. 34-year-old Oi Lee, who lives in Leland, went along as an interpreter. For Oi, it was a special trip back home to see her family after 14 years. She, too, described the hard life there.
They have no job around the area where they live. Whatever they work, just work in a field, in a rice field. If the floods come, that's all they work the whole year, just go over the water.
Oi says she would like to go back to her native home in 3 years. As for Rose Lewis, she also wants to return to Thailand.
Oh, yes. It's the people. I love the people. Of course, I love people everywhere. But these have a special place down in my heart.
I'm not sure if stores looked like this 100 or so years ago, but here at Wilmington's Cotton Exchange, they try to present that kind of flavor. Over the past year, we've met some people who make things that you might find in stores like this. Some of them make them for sale, some for fun.
DeWitt Bass of Wilmington began wood carving 60 years ago as a Boy Scout. No formal instruction, he was his own teacher. And through the years, he has become quite good at it. It was a part-time hobby until he retired in 1972. Since then, he has devoted much of his time to carving. And you may have already seen some of his work.
I have, up until the last couple of years, I'd go to about a dozen shows a year. I'm going to one or two now a year.
Tell me, Mr. Bass, is this an expensive hobby?
I teach wood carving with Cape Fear Tech, and I tell people that they can start and do good carving with an investment of $7 or $8. A good knife is all you have to have.
Some of DeWitt's carvings could be done in a few hours. Like this shark, it took 4 hours.
But others are more complicated. Say this particular piece right here. It's carved out of one solid piece of wood, and it took him 140 hours to complete.
Then there's this colorful cigar store Indian. It wasn't quite as tough to carve, but it did take well over 100 hours to finish it. In addition to wood, DeWitt also works with glass. This elephant is being shaped out of a piece of plexiglass. He uses a dental drill to do the work.
It must be a hobby that you enjoy, or you wouldn't be doing it, would you?
It's the most fun I've ever had. Lots of fun.
If you think whittling can test your patience, then put yourself to another test. Could you go back to the days of the Old West? The man you're about to meet takes that trip back in time nearly every day. Wayne Dixon of Wilmington is one of them.
I grew up with horses, and my grandfather raised them, and we used to show a lot. And I decided I wanted to get in the end of the business where I could make some money and still stay with the horses. And so I took up blacksmithing because it appealed to me, and I enjoyed it. And I went to school in Oklahoma Farriers College in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and came back here and settled down and been shoeing horses now for about 18 and a half years.
Wayne was a full-time farrier for a while, traveling three states, making horseshoes, shodding horses, and acting as a veterinarian. Then he got married and decided to settle down in his native Wilmington. He later taught horseshoeing at Cape Fear Tech. Now he works full-time at General Electric, but continues working as a farrier on the side.
Well, it varies. Sometimes I'll do two or three. Sometimes I might do 12 or 13 horses a week. It depends on the barns that I go to. Horses have to be done about every 6 weeks. And I have mine set up on a schedule, and I go and do them. And so it just depends on what week they happen to fall in as to how many I do.
If you lived 100 years ago or 200 years ago, would you be doing this? Would you be a blacksmith, you think?
Back then, I'd have had a shop, and it had just been a matter of going out in the morning and going to work. So I would probably enjoy it.
If you want to go back even further in time, all you have to do is find a man from Wilmington whose family is practically bathed in the heritage of North Carolina. The 400th anniversary celebration at Manio has an old-world flavor. You won't find hot dogs and soft drinks here, but you can enjoy cider, meat pies, and mashed beans. Chris Harper and his family supplied all of the British decorations and some of the food for the big event. They are one of the few importers of British goods and other items in the entire U.S.
We're thrilled. Of course, you know, it's a chance, of course, to see Princess Anne again, and the whole family is very staunch royalists. And
you say again, I guess you've seen her before?
Yeah, I have. We've never had the pleasure of meeting her, but we have seen a Princess Anne before, you know. I was born and raised in England, and used to go to school near Buckingham Palace, so every once in a while we'd catch a glimpse of the royal family coming out to the... that's a whole other story.
Chris says his family business is actually two in one. The Union Jack grew out of a coin shop.
Mother knew that there was a market in this type of thing because for years we've looked for British items, and she couldn't find them, so she decided to do something about it and started herself. And I think the time is ripe for something like this, and I'm just thrilled to see the British and the American people really working together on something as fascinating as this.
Thank you.
The Christmas holidays are a busy time. We might even complain a little bit about the crowded shopping malls, and the crowded streets might be hard to get around at times. But it was only three short months ago that there was something going on that week in September we had no control over. Hurricane Diana. Well, since then, we've told you about some of the people that went that second mile to help many of you recover from that storm. And it was this spirit of giving that demonstrated the true meaning of Christmas outside of the holiday season.
The day after Hurricane Diana, and while the effects of the storm are still being felt, the massive cleanup is already underway. The day before Diana hit, Wilmington contractor John Waff notified the North Carolina Highway Patrol that his men and equipment were available at any time to help in any way, at no charge. The morning after the hurricane came ashore, Mr. Waff was called. State troopers were cut off from entering Brunswick County due to fallen trees blocking the roads. It didn't take long for Mr. Waff to get on the way to help out.
Equipment was already loaded on the truck within a block of the house, so we were on the road in about 30 minutes from the time they called.
This week, Mr. Waff was honored by the Highway Patrol for his efforts.
Thank you very much, Mr. Waff. You're welcome. Thank you for your help.
Even the commander of the Highway Patrol, Colonel David Matthews, came to Wilmington to personally express his appreciation.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
John, his son Perry, and other family members braved 100-mile-per-hour winds as they cleared Brunswick County roads.
Well, there was trees all over the road every which way, and we just pushed and picked them up and put them right over on the side of the roads, cut them up out of, get them so we could get them out of the roads and make them through traffic.
Like, this is the first hurricane I've ever been through, and the high winds and all was something new. I've been in small wind, thunderstorms and stuff like that, and the only hurricane that I knew of that any significant force was Hurricane Hazel, and I was just a little fella.
Mr. Waff says he wouldn't hesitate to help out in a similar situation again. And as far as the recognition,
I suppose when you get a little recognition, you appreciate it. But it wasn't done for the to get recognition, it was just done for to help the Highway Patrol in the case of need.
We couldn't forget those wonderful people who looked after our safety during those difficult days. Two of them we revisit are among the many we can call special.
Confidential information.
Another training session to keep them in a constant state of readiness, knowing what to do if they're called out, whether it's natural or man-made disaster. Doris Eisenberg is Director of Disaster Services for the Cape Fear Chapter of the American Red Cross. She lends a helping hand, as in the case of a recent Wilmington fire.
There's a lot of situations, really, from servicing just the firemen, as you recalled on French Street recently. Serving them, we served approximately 30 gallons of water and about 35 cups of coffee. These are things that we do also.
Doris started out as a volunteer caseworker a little over 2.5 years ago. Now, in addition to disaster services, she heads up services for the armed forces and veterans. And there are many rewards.
What it actually does for an individual, in some small way, you realize you have helped someone. And it's a personal reward to know that you can help them.
In addition to Doris Eisenberg, Bill Heinberg plays an important role on the Red Cross team, both in the field and on the board of directors.
As chairman of the disaster team services, I'm responsible for putting together a mass of volunteers and making sure that they're trained and available and able to come out and perform.
And Bill says the local chapter is in constant need of help.
As a United Way agency, we don't have the funds to hire people to do this type of a job. We depend very much on volunteers, and you don't have to be talented or skilled to volunteer. All you have to do is be interested and care about other people.
There were many folks we could stamp with a label as heroes of Hurricane Diana, but if you'll relive with us the story of one man, you'll know just what his unsung effort meant to our communities.
A piece of information. I'll turn it now to our WWAY news director, Susan Bell. Susan.
Okay, I still have the weather report that I gave you about 10 minutes ago, and it was brand new at that time. So far,
can't... For many, these people were reassuring voices in the night as Hurricane Diana made her way through southeastern North Carolina.
The person responsible for keeping WAAV radio on the air was inside this transmitter building in Leland.
Station engineer Gary Morgan, his wife, and three children rode out the storm in this small building next to WAAV's transmitting tower.
It is quite bad out here. It'll get calm for a while, for about 50 minutes to a half hour, and then it'll get the winds will crank up again, and it'll really get bad. Right now, it is extremely bad out there. I just fed Old Bessie.
You used the generator as a backup power supply.
Right.
We used Old Bessie, and Bessie was running from 12 midnight. I cranked it up, and it ran until 8 o'clock the next evening.
Morgan said during the time WAAV was on generator power, he plugged in a microphone at the transmitter and patched the phone line in so DJ Don Encel and news director Susan Bell could help out at the Wilmington studio. The downtown studio had lost power, and both Encel and Bell relayed whatever information they could over the telephone.
Would you do it again?
Would I do it again? Yeah. In fact, it was... It's something that most likely I'll never forget. I told my children, I says, it's something you can tell your children. So, I'd do it again.
Busier than ever, with many of you bringing back the things that don't work, don't fit, or whatever. But we hope that Christmas means more to you than just the things you receive, like the true meaning of family, friendship, and love. For me and my family, and from all of us in the TV3 family, a very Merry Christmas and the best for you in 1985. I'm Jerry Brown. Good night.